Next up is Nitin Bhandari, Associate Vice President, New Product Development and Partnerships at Vodafone. Nitin is here. Nitin is responsible for driving the development of new products and partnerships for the enterprise business at Vodafone. He currently works on machine-to-machine communication, cloud, mobility, and hosted product ecosystems. He's a co-author of a book, GB924, the Service Model Framework, which is published by Telemanagement Forum, and has been a contributing editor to the Telecom Billing Dictionary. So a speaker, a writer, a technologist, Nitin?
I think as industry as well as consumers, all of us pretty much know about communication, so I don't need to introduce communications. Having said that, what I wanted to talk today was a new form of communication that's having a profound impact on businesses, business models, innovation, and so on. And wanted to kind of leave some thoughts behind on how you could use this new form of communication in your respective industries. So I do know you have got a case study, and so imagine yourself standing at a historical moment where, as an industry, you have got two choices to make. One, you have a glorious past, you have done very well, and one could continue living in glorious past. Or secondly, you could take steps into a very, very young future, okay, which may not be very well defined, is still young, but has the potential to become a glorious future. So let's talk a bit about communications, about the communication as we know, before I jump into this new form of communication that we call as machine-to-machine communications. So communication in India started in 1851, very humble beginnings. Okay, this is when the first telegraph service was introduced between Calcutta and Diamond Harbor. Okay, the distance was not more than few dozens of miles. And then it took us about 31 years to kind of evolve into the next thing, voice communication that we know of. The phones in those days did not really look anywhere closer to the phones that we know. Okay, so this is one of the real instruments from those days. So this was the first telephone service that was introduced in Calcutta. And at the end of first year, we had 93 subscribers in India. And I guess today we add more than this number every second in India. And then it took us many, many decades before we could jump onto the next phase. That was the automated exchange installed in Shimla. And then it took us even more decades, okay, to jump onto the next big thing called internet, as well as mobile phones. So 1995 is when internet was introduced in India, the public internet, when these guys' nodes were installed in five cities. And the same year, the first mobile service was introduced in India. And between 1995 and today, okay, in less than two decades, we have moved from being just a GSM country to 3G, 4G, and not only that, the telephone services are no longer limited to the niche elite. Rather, they have extended their reach to all walks of life. So that was past. Past was glorious. Now let's talk about some insights into the trends that have the potential to shape the future of industry. And when I say industry, I actually don't mean telecom industry. The potential to shape the future of each and every industry, where telecom just becomes an enabler. So I'll give you this real example. This example is of a car called Jipcar. It's a company, operates in New York, LA, and a few other cities. Now this happens to be a brick and mortar company where the primary business is leasing out or renting out cars. Now typically what you would see, and this is kind of the problem is also pretty much there in a place like Mumbai, where you have got a shortage of parking space, okay, where you don't really have spaces to put big car rental showrooms and so on. So what this company did was, rather than buying big lots of spaces, which anyways weren't available in places like Manhattan, they actually went and bought single parking lots, okay, like what we have in our streets. Second thing that they did was they removed all human touch points. Okay, so if as a customer, let's say they actually gave me something like a smart car, I go to the car, I go to the windscreen, kind of wave it, a smart meter inside the car reads it, verifies my data with a central server, kind of activates my insurance and so on. And then the door opens, it allows me to get in, I can drive, I can, so once I've reached my destination, I can actually park it at the nearest parking lot, which is actually owned by the same car company, and then I move out, okay, and that's it. Zero human touch points, everything was kind of enabled by communication, but at the same time, look at the number of industries which were kind of put together, which were joined together. Insurance companies, credit card, the parking spaces, RFID technologies, mobile, and so on. So the innovation that was done by this company was, okay, without a human intervention, how can I provide a service? Pretty much a new model. Something which, if adopted in India, could actually do wonders with a place like Mumbai. But not only that, there are many more opportunities. And the way the whole scenario is being driven is, so far we have kind of known kind of two internets. The first internet is Internet of Information, or the internet that we know of. Second is the internet of people, pretty much like Facebook's and LinkedIn, which came into picture, into being about what, last 5 years, last 7 years, and so on. And the third is Internet of Systems. And the Internet of Systems is all about, there's no human being really talking to each other, rather it's a machine talking to another machine. We are already seeing a number of cases in India. One of the most famous being, you would have seen these buses which have got GNNURM written on them. Okay, so all these buses, they actually come embedded with enough number of microsensors and way of communication between the buses and the central control rooms. And from a centralized control room, the operators could actually pretty much control or kind of monitor where the buses are, how long will it take for it to arrive at the next bus stop, and so on. Now, imagine a case whereby, you know, if I or my wife could get an SMS 5 minutes before my kids were to arrive at the bus stop, or 5 minutes before the bus that's carrying my kids were to arrive at the bus stop, then I don't need to really go and stand there in monsoon or in bright sun for half an hour and wait for the buses, and so on. And another example that I would want to talk about is smart meters. So typically in past, when it comes to any of the utility meters, be it water meters, electricity meters, gas meters, it's a human being that will come to my house or my industry premise to take the reading. Okay. Now there are obviously chances of fraud. I can always pay off this guy some money so that he takes less reading, and so on. But then what if these meter readings are sent over the air once in a week to the electric company? And then what if the electric company really needs, really wants, what it could do is automate the whole process, so there's no human touch point from taking the reading to actually taking the money out of my bank account or debiting the money to my bank account, and so on. Everything pretty much over the cloud. It's just that this cloud is not really cloud of information or IT that we know of, that it's a cloud of machined IT. And then information that could be sent to us in a real time. So that's where I actually wanted to get into a bit of more details into the what I would call the Internet of Things or Internet of Machine. And that's one of the topics that's been given to you. So how is this trend shaping up? So while this is not something that's just futuristic, what we're also finding is the number of machines that are connected to the net that are interconnected is rising faster than the number of voice connections or the human connections. And this is something that's primarily being led by industry's drive to improve processes, reduce losses, and so on. And the biggest growth is actually not coming from Europe or Americas. The biggest growth in M2M communication is coming from Asia Pacific. One of the reasons being most of the manufacturing activity of the world has actually shifted to this region. Call it Vietnam, call it China, call it India. But most of the manufacturing activity has kind of shifted to this region, and that's where machines are, where manufacturing facilities are, and hence machine-to-machine communication is increasing in this part of the world. But as an industry, as a CIO, how do you leverage? How could you leverage on this technology? And So what you will pretty much see is, you know, the devices could be anything. Okay, the device ecosystem could be anything here. As long as you have got a SIM card or a form of communication embedded into the device. And all your intelligence actually resides somewhere in the back end. Okay, all the intelligence somewhere resides in the back end. And what a typical M2M platform will provide is a way to get this information out to the back end where you have got all the intelligence residing, all the algorithms working, which will allow you to monitor as well as take appropriate steps to control it if something was going right or if something was going wrong. The applications and the use case are actually spread across the industry. So I've just given few examples here. So let's talk of utilities. The biggest application which we are actually seeing is about automatic meter reading, be it any kind of utility, gas pipes, water pipes, also street lights. In fact, in Mumbai, most of the street lights are actually controlled using M2M. You've got security monitoring. This is pretty much picking up now. Traditionally, when you had these remote CCTV cameras, you will have somebody watching them. But then if I have to install 100,000 CCTV cameras in India, in Mumbai, I can't really have 100,000 people or 10,000 people really monitoring them. Ideally, someone in the police forces or the defense forces, they should get an alarm only if something is going wrong. This kind of technology is already there pretty much in a number of other countries and being deployed in India now. Smart energy, and then in manufacturing, it's mostly around asset tracking. It's about remote asset management. So based on certain climate conditions or weather conditions, can I switch on or switch off certain assets? Logistics and transportation. Now, by definition, logistics and transportation, all the assets, they're always mobile. So it's all about vehicle tracking, cargo tracking, diagnostics, digital signages, and so on. And then retail and healthcare, primarily around POS terminals. And most of you would have received a credit card over the past year or so, typically. And if somebody from Blue Dart came and gave you this credit card, he would have given you a kind of a terminal on top of which you made your signature. And I don't know if you notice or not, if you actually go to the internet and then go to the Blue Dart site, and if you put the tracking number, almost instantly you will see that the delivery has been updated. Okay, while in India they don't show display the signatures, in some other countries they also display the signatures. This is something which gives a lot of satisfaction to the customers, also enables new business models, and that's possibly the reason why many of us are happy to pay more money to somebody who is tracking our cargo or tracking our consignments, vis-a-vis someone who just takes the guarantee of delivery and don't really give us a tracking mechanism. Healthcare, another field in India. It's mostly around remote healthcare, and while in larger cities like Mumbai, yes, you have got specialist hospitals, but then what happens to smaller cities? And people do have the potential to pay, but yes, the healthcare, they don't have access to the healthcare. But with machine to machine, yes, you can get into remote healthcare. You could do self-diagnostics, remote diagnostics, and so on. So kind of, I will stop here, but I actually wanted to show a couple of short videos, and let me start with this automatic and electronic toll.
Machine-to-machine technology can create greater efficiencies in terms of time, cost, comfort, and personal safety. The onboard diagnostic system of this car has identified a mechanical problem, and an internal transmitter relays this information to a breakdown service. The driver receives an automatically generated SMS notification that a breakdown vehicle is on its way, with an estimated time of arrival given. Having received data about the fault and model type, the breakdown service is able to arrive at the scene with the correct unit to install. Using connected navigation with real-time traffic information, they are able to take the most efficient route, arriving quickly and maximizing fuel efficiency. The unit is successfully fitted and the car is able to continue on its journey, with the driver's inconvenience and loss of time kept to a minimum. This technology has many further practical applications. from remote unlocking in the event of a lost key, where an operator is able to start the car and then transmit details of the nearest garage to the onboard navigation system, to remote tracking of a stolen vehicle. Remote disabling of an engine is also possible. In even more extreme conditions, M2M technology could also be responsible for saving lives. For instance, if a driver was left unconscious after an accident in a remote location. Other M2M applications could include a full in-car information system, providing car diagnostics and servicing updates, a web browser, infotainment services, and even home management systems, allowing you to check the status of individual appliances and remotely turn them off or on if necessary, all from the comfort of your own car.
I'll just show one more video before I log off.
Conveniently located around the city, vending machines are accessible 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. But keeping a machine replenished can be a logistical challenge. Now, with machine-to-machine communications, city commuters or pedestrians will easily make their purchase using a mobile device which executes secure payments at the vending machines contact-free. The payment transaction is processed to the vendor automatically. Furthermore, with M2M, the vending machine will automatically send information to a central database where buying patterns can be analyzed to maximize profit opportunities. Regular inventory updates will also be sent to a local distribution warehouse and the replenishment service. This allows the automated pickers to collate exactly the right mix to replenish each machine on a route. Each delivery van is then given a replenishment route that minimizes their journey time and reduces costs by optimizing the route. Whilst the van is traveling through the city, their navigation device will guide them through the most efficient route, integrating real-time traffic information, making the whole operation both fuel and time efficient. Data on driving time, speed, fuel usage, and car service issues, such as tire pressures and oil usage, are also generated and automatically sent to the logistics center to ensure that every van in the fleet is adequately maintained. When large trucks are deployed for deliveries to the distribution warehouse, their exact position, as well as driver time and fuel levels, are monitored by the logistics company to enable them to redeploy trucks at a moment's notice to minimize empty returns.
Thanks so much. Best wishes for your case studies. And yeah, if you want to see other videos, you can always drop by the stand behind you. Thanks.